In these last days, in these chaotic days, let us continue to look unto the Lord. If you have your Bibles, please open with me to the Revelation of Jesus Christ, chapter 17. And as you do, would you please stand with me? Revelation chapter 17. We'll begin in verse 1, reading together. Today's message, the coming world religion. Then one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls came and talked with me, saying to me, "Come, I will show you the judgment of the great harlot who sits on many waters, with whom the kings of the earth committed fornication, and the inhabitants of the earth were made drunk with the wine of her fornication." So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sitting on a scarlet beast, which is full of names of blasphemy, having seven heads and ten horns. The woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet and adorned with gold and precious stones and pearls, having in her hand a golden cup full of abominations and the filthiness of her fornication. And on her forehead a name was written, "Mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and of the abominations of the earth." I saw the woman drunk with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I marveled with great amazement. Let's offer this Bible study to the Lord. Jesus, we come here, Lord, and we thank you that not only have you loved us with a great love, you have cleansed us from our sin and all impurity, and you have called us and made us your own. And all throughout your New Testament, Lord, you call on us to walk worthy of the calling we have received. And Lord, we know that there will be an apostate church here on the earth. But even now, that spirit that works through that false religion is at work today. And you call us to remain in intimate relationship with you. You call us to walk in the Spirit. You call us to be pure and to remain pure by looking unto you. So, Lord, with that in mind, we ask that you give us eyes to see and ears to hear and a mind to understand what you, the Spirit, would say to us, the church. Give us the heart to receive this glorious gospel, for truly it is glorious. And it is the good news that has saved us, cleansed us, and sealed us until the day you come. In your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen. Please be seated. In Revelation chapter 16, we're at the end of the tribulation. And John has shown seven angels who are commanded to pour out seven bowls of God's wrath, unmixed, undiluted, the fullness of the fierceness of his righteous, holy indignation that's poured out upon a Christ-rejecting world. And as you read that, you wonder how in the world could anybody survive the plagues that are poured out upon them? How could anybody survive, first of all? And the second question is, why in the world would they not repent and turn to the one who can save them? Well, the second question is answered in this: men love darkness rather than light. And we're told three different times that as God is pouring out his righteous wrath, his just wrath upon a Christ-rejecting world, that instead of turning to him and trusting him for salvation, they shake their fist at him, blaspheme him, and curse them for the plagues that are being poured out. Men love darkness rather than light. The answer to the first question is simply this: Jesus said, because of how horrible this time is going to be and how this is the fullness of the fierceness of God's wrath, unless those days were cut short, no flesh would survive. So how terrible will it be? Well, depending on how many you think will go in the rapture, professing Christianity is over 1 billion inhabitants here on the earth. Only God truly knows who belongs to him and who doesn't. And by the way, God doesn't wonder about that. Paul told Timothy in 2 Timothy, his second letter to Timothy, he said, God knows who are his because his name is written on their heart. So everybody that makes it to heaven is truly born again. So all those who are born again, let's say it is 1 billion people. That's 1/7 of the earth. And then as we read through the seven seals, we're told 1/4 of the earth will be destroyed by that. As we read through the seven trumpets, another 1/3 of the earth is destroyed by that. As we come to the seven bowls, all those barriers, all those restraints are lifted and is the fullness of God's wrath. One commentator compared it to Europe after the Black Plague, which is either in the 9th or 10th century, that you could travel for days upon days without seeing anybody or coming in contact with a living soul because so many people had been killed by that plague. You could walk through villages and towns and even some cities, and it was like ghost towns because of so many people that had been wiped out by the plague. By the time we come to Revelation chapter 16, by the time we come to the end of the tribulation, most of the inhabitants of the earth are either in heaven because of the rapture, or because they've been martyred for their faith, or they've already gone to Hades, that is the temporary abode of the wicked, awaiting their sentence of condemnation. Very few people left upon planet earth. And Jesus said, unless God cut those days short, none would survive. If there's any good news in this, it's in verse 17 of chapter 16. It says, and the seventh angel poured out his bowl into the air, and a loud voice came out of the temple of heaven from the throne, saying, it is done. And so when that seventh bowl is poured out, the plagues have come to an end. The plagues have done what God has commissioned the plagues to do. It is done. And so what we have here in chapter 17 all the way to the end is that John is being shown the ramifications of the end of the tribulation and what takes place after the tribulation. Could you for a moment look at verse 19 of chapter 6 and says, now the great city was divided into three parts and the cities of the nations fell, and great Babylon was remembered before God to give her the cup of the wine of the fierceness of his wrath. So in the midst of this seventh bowl being poured out, this angel says to John, I am going to now show you in detail what happens to Babylon the Great, that her judgment will be greater than all the other judgments before her. Think about that. Babylon. What is Babylon? Well, we know that Babylon was a literal city from Genesis chapter 10. We also know that Babylon is not only a literal city, but it is also a system. It is a religious system, anti-God and anti-Christ, but a religious system it is. And there's also a political and economic system. So what we have here in chapter 17, in the fierceness of God's wrath, he pours out the most intense judgment of his righteousness upon this first in chapter 17, the religious system of Babylon. And in chapter 18, the political and economic system of Babylon. And that's good news for us. You know why? Because what follows those judgments is chapter 19, which is the second coming of our great God and Savior, Jesus the Christ. And so that is a wonderful thing. And it is a beautiful truth. And so here we have the judgment upon Babylon the Great. Babylon was a literal city, and there's no other city outside of Jerusalem that's mentioned more times in the Old and New Testament. Some 287 times Babylon is mentioned, and the only other city that's mentioned more is Jerusalem, the city of God, almost 400 times. Jerusalem is mentioned. So some say, and I agree with this, really the Bible is the tale of two cities. A city of wickedness and a city of righteousness. A city of Satan, a city of God. A city which will damn millions to everlasting torment, and the city of God, which the Bible said, Paul told the Galatians that we're born of the New Jerusalem. We're citizens of the New Jerusalem. So as we go through this, we'll see that God is referring really to a literal city, but also to a spiritual city, a city of harlotry, a city of fornication, a city that is the beginning of and the mother of all pagan religion. So it says here in verse 1 of chapter 17, it says, then one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls came and talked with me. So the one of the seven angels, I think, is probably the seventh angel who had told John, come and I will show you the judgment of Babylon the Great. And so he invites him to come and see in a very descriptive detail the fall of Babylon. Now, I don't know about John, I don't know about you, but if I was an eyewitness to these horrible things taking place, you know, the last thing I want to do is to see more. I wonder if John thought, well, that's okay, I'm going to go on. You don't have to show me. But here he's inviting them, and I'd be kind of scared. I mean, this is an angel pouring out the fierceness of God's wrath. I really don't want to be close to him. But yet, John is invited to come, and he's saying to me, come, I will show you the judgment of the great harlot who sits on many waters. And as I've said before, the word judgment means the weighing of scales. And so the judgment that Babylon receives, as all wicked people receive, is in accordance with God's righteous standard. That the sins and iniquities of Babylon are being weighed against the righteousness and holiness and purity of Almighty God. And he says, this judgment is in accordance with your sins. God is righteous in his judgment. What is the righteous standard of God? What is the judgment that's given to Babylon? Isaiah answers that for us in Isaiah chapter 47. Isaiah says, but these two things shall come to you, speaking of Babylon, in a moment, in one day. The loss of children and widowhood that shall come upon you in their fullness, undiluted, intense, the full wrath of God because of the multitude of your sorceries. For the great abundance of your enchantments. For you have trusted in your wickedness. You have said, no one sees me. Your wisdom and your knowledge have warped you. Only the fool says in his heart, there is no God. And you have said in your heart, I am. And that is a direct threat to Almighty God. Even though it was a threat, God scoffs at that idea. There's only one I am. And there's only one I am, and he is not threatened, but here, Babylon, in her pride, and in her sorcery, and in her wickedness, is doing what man will do at the end of the tribulation, is shake their fists at God and say, you say that you are the great I am, I am. And you have said in your heart, I am, and there is no one else besides me. And so because of this wickedness, because of their sorceries, because of their occultic religion, God says to this spiritual system, to this spiritual Babylon, I am going to pour out the fullness of the intensity of my holy, just, righteous wrath upon you. And I am just in doing this. Because you claim to be God. And how intense will it be? He says in one day and in one moment. Where we have been following the plagues of God throughout a 7-year time period. The one that comes up on spiritual and political and economic Babylon will be in one day and in one moment. It will be something that has never existed before will ever be done again to man. And one day, the loss of life. And one day, sudden destruction. And it'll be so sudden and so great that there will be no inhabitation ever again in the literal city or in the spiritual city. Come, I will show you the judgment of the great harlot who sits on many waters. So John has shown this harlot. What is this harlot? And I actually like the King James word better because King James doesn't pull any punches. John has shown the great whore. Who is the great whore of Babylon? Who is this great harlot of Babylon? Well, as you know, the book of Revelation has over 400, almost 500 verses. Almost 300 of the verses in the book of Revelation have an allusion to or connected to the Old Testament. In fact, it is good to have a grasp of the Old Testament so you can begin to understand everything that God has shown in the Revelation. So what is in the Old Testament that gives us the identity of this harlot or the characters of this harlot? In the Old Testament, specifically in the book of the minor prophet Hosea, God is writing to Hosea about his wife, about God's wife. God is writing to Hosea about God's wife. Who is the wife of God? The nation of Israel. All throughout the Old Testament, The nation of Israel, specifically in the book of Hosea, is called the wife of God. And God is complaining that his wife is not staying true to the marriage vows, to the covenant vows that they've been given. That his wife has strayed into fornication, has strayed into harlotry or to whoredom. And meaning that she is selling herself to the highest bidder. And in some cases, Ezekiel said that she's actually offering her seductive ways for free to anybody that comes by. And this harlotry that's taken place is not sexual sin, it is spiritual sin. That they are lusting after, and they are craving, and they are following after what Paul the Apostle calls, quote unquote, so-called gods. They are following and worshiping and bowing down to idols. And God says that this is whoredom. This is harlotry. This is a departure from the vow that I made with you. In the New Testament, the bride of Christ is the church. That we are called, because we have been purified, to live pure. Because we have been separated from the world unto Jesus, who is the bridegroom, and we are the bride, we are to live separate from the world system in which we live. And so it's interesting that you have the two brides, the bride of God, Israel, and the bride of the church, the bride of Jesus, the church. We're called to purity. And whenever Israel or the church begins to follow idols or to bow down to idols, God considers it harlotry. He considers it fornication. He considers it compromise. So if the church is the bride of Jesus Christ and the harlot is spiritual adultery, who is the harlot that John is seeing? He's not seeing Israel. He is seeing the apostate church. This is a church that will be organized and formed after the true church is removed from the earth. They will come under one umbrella. It will be all in the name of hashtag unity, hashtag one brotherhood, hashtag inclusiveness. And they'll all come under one umbrella, and they'll see themselves as something, well, they'll desire it. They'll be very proud of themselves, but God looks at it as harlotry. What is the apostate church? It is man's religion. Religion simply means, the most basic definition, to relink. This will be man's attempt to relink with God outside of Jesus Christ. Now, let me tell you how God sees man's religion trying to relink with him without Jesus Christ. John pulls no punches. In his first letter, chapter 2, he says that any man who tries to come to God outside of Jesus Christ is actually operating under the spirit of Antichrist. There is no way to relink with God outside faith in Jesus Christ. And this harlot will be man's attempt to create utopia, create a world religion where all are welcomed. Live however you want to live. Call the name of your God, any name you want to call it. Do whatever you want to do, but you're all coming together because there are many paths to heaven. There are many ways to God, and no one is going to be intolerant of how you see that. And it says that those who do this will bear the brunt of the great judgment of God. It says here in verse 2, with whom the kings of the earth committed fornication. And in terms that we can understand, it's always interesting during a political season how many of our politicians go to churches, go to baby dedications, go to potluck suppers, who want to begin with prayer, if it's politically correct to begin in prayer. In fact, they pray, but you're just not allowed to say, you know the name. You're not allowed to say it. We have no political correctness here. His name is Jesus, right? And they will have this marriage with this harlot, that the ruling king of that day and during the tribulation will have this political alliance with the harlot. And it says that they commit fornication, spiritual adultery with her. and the inhabitants of the earth were made drunk with the wine of her fornication. They will be intoxicated. She'll be very seductive. Religion's very seductive. It's because it's all about what man can do to be like God, to act like God, to reconnect with God. And what they become intolerant of is telling you that there's only one way to do that is through Jesus Christ. I was up late last night and I was reading about George Whitefield. Have you ever read about George Whitefield, the English preacher that came over here during the first awakening in America in the 18th century? He was a highly anointed preacher of the Gospels, and multitudes would go to his rallies wherever he was and up in the Northeast to listen to him. And they would sit there just almost spellbound by the scripture that was coming out of his mouth. And many men and women came to faith to Jesus Christ during his time. But not only was he highly sought after to go and hear, but he was also very controversial. He's controversial because George Whitefield, much like the New Testament, didn't pull any punches. He called sin, sin. And he called those who were professing Christians to quit living a life of compromise and to live a life of purity. Well, that didn't go over too well. In the streets, they loved him, but churches found him too controversial. And churches refused, many of them, to allow him to come and stand in their pulpits to preach. And when he was allowed to come, his biographer talks about the times he was so controversial, simply calling sin, sin, just calling sin, sin, and calling people salvation. They would throw rotten eggs at him. They would throw stones at him. And I found this very interesting. I don't know if it happened one time, more than one time, but someone actually threw a dead cat at him because they just reviled the message that was coming out of his mouth. The apostate church wants to hear nothing about sin, wants to hear nothing about repentance, wants to hear nothing about the cross, nothing about the life, death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, wants to hear nothing about God judging the world. They are intoxicated by religion and they despise Jesus Christ. That's what Jesus meant in John chapter 15. It says the world will persecute you. The world will seek to kill you, thinking they're doing God a favor. But it's not you they hate. It's me they hate. How do I know that's true? Well, first of all, Jesus said it. But just if you want to have a test case, when you're at work tomorrow or in a group of people and they're talking about, you know, will you pray for me? I'd like to be healed. Or would you pray for my children to have a good year in the school year? And say, I'd love to. Jesus can do amazing things. Just say Jesus and see what kind of reaction you're going to get. And I'm going to tell you something. If you like stirring up trouble, just bring Jesus into a conversation. If you like to be uninvited to a family reunion, bring Jesus into a conversation. If your friends are wanting you to go and do something with them that you're not comfortable with doing, just bring Jesus into the conversation. I guarantee you they don't want you to go. Because the world loves its sin. And the world loves darkness. And the enemy of our soul, which is Satan, has blinded them to their sin. They are drunk and intoxicated and craving for more of their sin. And that's what religion does. You know, Paul told Timothy and Jesus told us that the traditions of men, the outward rituals of religion, do nothing to restrain the indulgences of the flesh. You can look pretty, you can talk pretty, but you're still ugly inside. And that's what the world religion is all about. Looking pretty, sounding pretty, being inclusive, and that is a key word today, being inclusive. Invited everybody, letting people love who they want to love or how they want to love or what they define marriage to be or what should and should not be taught in school. Some of the things that are going on in the public school system, and thank God I haven't heard much here in our community, but there are some places, even in preschool, it makes me blush just to hear the things they want to talk to our preschool children about. And they feel like they're just so cultured. And so elevated in their thinking. And they feel so good about themselves. But when God looks down, he sees them as nothing more than a whore. Clothed in her filthiness. Damning themselves and all those who would follow to a devil's hell. So it says here in verse 3, so he carried me away in the spirit. So just like on the when he was carried in the spirit to the Lord's day or the 7-year tribulation in Revelation chapter 1, he is now caught up in the spirit and he's taken into the wilderness. It could be he was taken into a literal wilderness, but more people think that he was taken back to the wilderness right after the flood in Genesis chapter 9 and 10. That the world after the flood was uninhabited. It had been made desolate. It was no one to be found except for Noah and his family. But one thing it was, it didn't have any inhabitants and didn't have any mega cities. But one thing it was pure. Because God had wiped sin off the face of the earth. So some believe that he was taken back to the wilderness right after the flood of Noah, and that he's going to be shown the panoramic view of where this apostate religion began all the way to the end at the second coming. So if that be true, and I think it is, he's taken in the spirit and he's seen the earth after Noah's day, after Noah's flood, all the way up to the second coming. He says, and I saw a woman sitting on a scarlet beast. This woman is the harlot whom the kings are committing spiritual fornication with, and she is sitting on a scarlet beast, which was full of names of blasphemy, having 7 heads and 10 horns. If you have been with us through this study, you know in Revelation chapter 11 and Revelation chapter 13 that this scarlet beast with the name full of names of blasphemy, having 7 heads and 10 horns, is none other than the kingdom of Antichrist and the Antichrist himself. So this apostate religion is going to ride on the back and be in partnership with the Antichrist. This apostate church is going to be the useful fool for the Antichrist. And she will carry a lot of power. And the false prophet will be ahead of this harlot. And through the signs and wonders and miracles that are given to him by Satan, he will deceive the whole world, and they will follow after this beast, and they will worship this beast, and they will call this beast God. And it says here in verse 4, the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet and adorned with gold and precious stones and pearls, having in her hand a golden cup full of abominations. She is beautiful to look at. She is very powerful. She is very wealthy. You compare the false church to the first century church of John's day, and he had no wonder he wondered with great wonder the wealth that this church has, the power and authority this church has. When John was writing this, Christians were hiding in caves because the Caesars were hunting them down and killing them by the thousands, if not millions. And yet he sees a so-called church that is accepted by the empire of Rome in his day, and it will be accepted during the tribulation, much as it is accepted today. False religions on the rise. Americans specifically are becoming more spiritual, but that doesn't mean that they're becoming more Christian. I think that we can be in agreement that we are less Christian. In fact, the definition of Christianity is so varied. But there's only one Christian, and that is the Christian of the Bible. That a man or woman has placed their faith in the name of Jesus and Jesus alone for salvation from their sins. And so here you have this beautiful, seductive, wealthy, powerful religion seducing not only the kings of the earth, being used as a useful idiot by the Antichrist, but the multitudes will give themselves to this religion because religion feels good. It's what you can do. That's why it's very interesting that in some churches today, more preference is given to the ritual and sacraments of the church and the symbols of the church and the festivities of the church and actually giving themselves to the one who died for them. I'd be very wary of any church that was all about symbols and all about rituals, and spend more time talking out of the book that gives the government of their denomination or gives them the rules for conducting a service, then give more time to that than giving to the Word of God itself. I'd be very wary of that. Because the power of God is not in rituals. It's not in the sacraments. It's not in even the celebrations. The power of God is in the gospel. The gospel is the good news that God has come in human form. And that if any man or woman places their faith in them, they will be saved from their sins. That is the gospel. That is the good news. It's not in the rituals. It's not in the sacraments. It's not in the celebrations. It's not in the keeping of the Sabbath day. It's not even keeping of the Ten Commandments. It is following and trusting in the one true God, Jesus the Christ. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 15 and Mark chapter 7, because the Pharisees were criticizing Jesus' disciples for not washing their hands before eating. Because they had this very elaborate, detailed ceremony they would go through so they would not defile their food. I remember reading about the fall of Constantinople, which is now Istanbul today. And my understanding in the history book that I read, that the church there in Constantinople, as they were under siege by the Muslims, that they had a conference, and the three items on their agenda, and I kid you not about this, the three items on their agenda is the color of Virgin Mary's eyes, the gender of angels, and if a fly was to fly into holy water, would the fly defile the water, or the water sanctify the fly? Now, if you have to have a conference about that, you have a lot darker problems than even a siege by the Muslims. But that's what they were caught up in. That's what they're caught up in. And of course, Constantinople fell and became Istanbul. They're so interested in the exterior things. And Jesus denounced the Pharisees. He calls them hypocrites. He calls them sons of hell. He calls them vipers. Because not only are they themselves damned, but they're going to blind their followers and damn them also into an eternal hell. Jesus said, it's not the washing of hands that makes someone pure. It's not eating of food that defiles someone. He says, you clean the outside of the cup, but the inside is still dirty. You're so concerned about what you put into your body that you're not concerned about what you put into your spiritual man. Because it's not what goes into a man that defiles him. It's what comes out of a man that defiles him. All the sins and the hideous sins of the flesh that men commit come from the heart. And there's going to be a so-called church here during the tribulation. Outwardly, they will be beautiful. Outwardly, they will be influential. Outwardly, they will be wealthy beyond our wildest imagination. But inside, as Jesus said, they are full of wickedness, iniquity, greed, adultery, fornication, and murder. And another way Jesus said it, they're full of dead men's bones. There's no life in them whatsoever. And it says here in verse 5, we are told, John is told now, remember, he's taken in this vision all the way back to Noah's day, all the way forward to the second coming. And we are told the root back in Noah's day of this false religion, of this pagan religion. And it says, and on her forehead, a name was written. In John's day, that not only did prostitutes, dress themselves in very seductive clothing to draw men to them, but they also wrote their name on their forehead. I don't find that attractive, by the way, but whatever. So that's what's going on there. And on her forehead, a name was written. And I think the symbolism here is that this false church is very proud, very arrogant. We'll see in chapter 18, she says, I am a queen. I have no husband, and there's none that can bring me down. Yeah, right. So it says here, mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and of the abominations of the earth. Mystery is a truth that has been hidden that's now revealed. And God is going to reveal to John and to us today that this Babylon the Great has existed from ancient times. I mentioned that it's right after Noah's flood. We're told this in Genesis chapter 10. It says, Cush begat Nimrod. He began to be a mighty one on the earth. He was a mighty hunter before the Lord. Therefore, it is said, like Nimrod, the mighty hunter before the Lord. And the beginning of his kingdom was Babel. And then it lists the other kingdoms that he found. Babel is Babylon. Babel was formed by Nimrod. And the Bible says he was a mighty hunter before the Lord. It doesn't mean that he was a good guy who liked to hunt. It doesn't mean that he was proficient in hunting. Literally in the Hebrew, he was a hunter of souls. In the Hebrew, it says that he lived before the Lord in rebellion. And that he was a wicked man. And he lived before the Lord in rebellion. And he went hunting for souls. And he is the founder of Babel, which is Babylon. In chapter 11, it is the story of the Tower of Babel. Man already had rebelled against God's command in Genesis chapter 9 when he told them to scatter and go throughout the earth. Instead, they congregated in the plain of Shinar, which is where Babel is located, there in modern day Iraq. And they gathered together and they built for themselves a tower, which was a ziggurat. It's not a cigarette, it's a ziggurat. A ziggurat is simply a tower that is made with a temple at the top where you can communicate and worship the sun, the moon, and the constellation of the stars. You want to know where horoscopes begin? This is the Tower of Babel. It's all the way back to then. This is in Ur of the Chaldeans, or in the Valley of Shinar, or Babel. Ur is a moon goddess. So they celebrated the moon goddess. They celebrated the sun as a god. They celebrated the constellation of the stars and worshiped them. And it says that Nimrod was the founder of this, and he was also the leader of this great religion. What they're doing is they're defying God, and they are worshiping the constellation of the universe. They're worshiping the creation rather than the creator. And as you know, God came down and said, you know, we're going to do something about this. By the way, he says, we are going to do something about this. He's not talking to himself. He's talking to the Trinity. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And said, let's come down and confuse their language. And that's how they were scattered, because they all spoke different languages. You ever wonder why you don't understand your wife? Thank Babel for that. If your wife doesn't speak anything you understand, that's why. If your husband doesn't understand anything you're saying, thank Babel for that. We've been confused since then, and we're still confused today. In fact, that's what Babel means, confusion. Now, let me give you a little context of Nimrod and Babel. This is history. This is not the Bible. But history says that Nimrod married a woman by the name of Semiramis. Semiramis claimed to have a virgin birth. Tammuz was the son's name. Tammuz grew up in the world of Nimrod's day. Nimrod and Semiramis married. Tammuz was supposed to be an immaculate conception. I wonder where he got that from, right? So he had immaculate conception, and after a while, he died. 40 days, if I remember right. 40 days he was dead and then raised back to life. And they worshiped them at Babel. And the statues that were erected, will sound very familiar, was a mother holding her child. You ever wonder where some of these statues and the people that worship them, where they come from? It comes from Babel. And there, John is told that this is the mother of harlots, that false religion, pagan religion, began in the Valley of Shinar, at the Tower of Babel, under the rule of Nimrod. She's the mother of all harlots and abominations of the earth. From her have come all the ancient paganisms: Chinese Confucianism, Asian Buddhism, Indian Hinduism, Shamanism, Taoism, Shintoism, Animism, Astrology, Witchcraft, Spiritism, Sikhism, and all the world's vast complex of gods and lords. They all proceed from there. And I want to add to this, and what John is saying, that any religion, whether they call it one God or many gods, outside of faith in Jesus Christ, comes from the mother of harlots. It is whoredom. It is harlotry. It is fornication to think that you can worship God outside of the person of Jesus Christ. And it says here in verse 6, this is the consequence of following this harlot, of following this false religion. It says here in verse 6, I saw the woman drunk with the blood of the saints as Jezebel hunted down the believers in Yahweh and the book of Kings. So this harlot will hunt down true Christians, those who have placed their faith in Jesus after the rapture. And in fact, this is not just those Christians mowed down during the tribulation. False religion, this harlot has been hunting down Christians ever since Christians were brought into the world at the day of Pentecost. I saw the woman drunk with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. Specifically, the followers of Jesus are hated by religion. Do you hear it today? Do you hear the intolerance that's taken place in the social discourse of our nation? Do you hear it in the halls of our politicians? Do you hear the disgust and the distaste and the outright hatred of a true Christian? Oh, they'll quote the Sermon on the Mount. They'll quote the Ten Commandments when it benefits them. But just as Paul was persecuted for believing in the grace of God, that is salvation through faith in Jesus Christ, so it is happening in our world today. And what's going to happen is going to be an increase of mistrust, of mockery, and then it's going to be bloodshed. And when we come to this point, millions will have been martyred for the faith. And it's not just ISIS. It is the religious world. Read about the Inquisition and the millions of people that died because of their faith in Jesus Christ. I was reading about John Wycliffe. He was a Catholic priest. He was excommunicated from the Catholic Church, and he died, and the Catholic Church hated him so much that it exhumed his bones and burned them. Why? What was his great sin? What was his great apostate that caused him to be excommunicated and to have his body exhumed and burned again? He determined that God's word was so important that every man should have a copy in his native language. That was it. That was the reason for it. That's why they killed him. Religion attempts to kill the true Christian. Attempts to do it. And it's happening in our world today. Do you know, I know you know this, but it's hard to think about. But Oregon, our culture celebrated because Oregon has said that abortions are for free. And that the insurance companies have to cover the copay. And that the taxpayers have to fund it. And the mainstream media applauds it. Oh, we're so enlightened. We're so cultured that we can provide this service for women. Over in Iceland, they've determined a way to keep Down syndrome babies from us having to deal with them is to abort them in the womb. Oh, how illuminated they are. How cultured they are. They are butchers. They are murderers. And our culture celebrates it. And it's all done in the name of religion. And where does it stop? First of all, it is maybe, you know, a deformed baby in the womb, or maybe it is a baby you don't want to have out of convenience, you know, because it's an inconvenience. Then what about the infirm? And then what about the elderly? And then what about those who weigh too much, or those who are too short, or those who are too tall, or those who are too buff? Well, they'll probably make it. But what about all those people? What about all those people? Where does it end? It comes from this false religion. That's what's spurring all this on. The idea that there is no God and we are God. I am, is what we're saying to the Lord. And I can determine my course, my path, what I want to do. It says here in verse 6, and when I saw her, I marveled with great amazement. Literally in the Greek, I marveled with great marvel. But the angel said to me in verse 7, why do you marvel? I will tell you the mystery of the woman and the beast that carries her, which has seven heads and 10 horns. The beast that you saw was and is not and will ascend out of the bottomless pit and go to perdition. Thanks, John. That makes a lot of sense. What that says here is the beast that you saw was and is not and will ascend out of the bottomless pit and go to perdition. Back in chapter 13, we saw this hideous beast and he received a mortal head wound. And then he is healed of that mortal head wound. And we're told that when he is, that the spirit from the abyss, that Satan himself will come out of the abyss and possess him, and he will take off the mask, and the world will see him as he is. He is the Antichrist, and he demands all men to worship him. So he says, this beast you saw was and is not, and will ascend out of the bottomless pit and go to perdition. And all those who dwell on the earth will marvel, whose names are not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world, when they see the beast that was and is not and yet is. Verse 9, here is the mind which has wisdom. The seven heads are seven mountains on which the woman sits. Some think that the seven mountains, in your translation, I know in the King James, says seven hills. And they say, well, because there's a city that has seven hills, this harlot will come out of the city of Rome. It could be. But the problem with that, that's very limited in scope by saying, well, it's the Roman Catholic Church that will do this. Only the Roman Catholic Church has this type of influence, maybe. But what we read here is an apostate religion that has the whole world under its spell, has the whole world deceived, and it's beyond Rome. And the other problem is, even though it says seven hills in the King James, it literally the better translation is seven mountains. And that's what's in the New King James. And mountains, beginning in Daniel chapter 2, always represents kingdoms and kings. And plus, Rome's not the only city built on seven hills. Istanbul is a city built on seven hills. And there's a numerous other cities in Asia and also in Europe that have a city built on seven hills. I don't know, maybe Manhattan's built on seven hills. I haven't noticed that, but maybe they are. But it says here that it's seven mountains. So I think it's better to see this as seven kingdoms, to see this sitting on the kingdoms of the earth, that this harlot is sitting and committing fornication with the seven kingdoms. And again, this goes all the way back to Noah's time and Nimrod's time, when this great false religion was created, and there will be seven kingdoms that will arise up out of the earth from that time forward. And we know what they are according to the Old Testament. We know the first kingdom was Egypt. Then the second kingdom was Assyria. Then the third kingdom was Babylon. And the fourth kingdom was the Medo-Persians. The fifth kingdom was Greece under Alexander the Great. The sixth kingdom was Rome. And the seventh kingdom will be the kingdom that's ruling during the tribulation. How do I know this? Look at verse 10. There are also seven kings. Five has fallen. One is, and the other has not yet come. Five kingdoms have fallen. Egypt, Assyria, Babylon, Persia, Greece. They have fallen. One is, that is Rome of John's day, and the other has not yet come. And when he does come, he must continue a short time, 42 months, 3.5 years. The beast that was and is not is himself also the eighth, and his other seven is going to perdition. Again, this Antichrist will rise up to bring a temporary peace to the world in chaos. He will confirm a covenant with Israel for 7 years, and for the first 3.5 years, the world will think that everything's going to go on as usual. There will be this one beautiful religion that everybody can belong to. I was watching the news last night, and there is a church of the cannabis in Colorado where they come together. They call themselves the Elevated Ones. Oh, yeah, that's cool. And so they use marijuana as a sacrament. Oh, it's beautiful, man. So, and they'll have this one beautiful religion, and everybody can belong to it, and they're going to love themselves for it. The beast that was and is not is himself also ate. So these kingdoms have ridden this harlot all this time. But there's going to come a time at the middle part of the tribulation, 3.5 years, according to Matthew 24:15, that the Antichrist will come into Jerusalem, come into the temple, desecrate the sacrifices, defile the sacrifice. Daniel and Jesus both called the abomination of desolation, and he'll declare himself to be God. And he will have no more use for his useful idiot. He'll get rid of religion because he is religion, and he's the only one that can be worshiped. And it says that he will be the one, and I believe what happens is that after he receives that mortal head wound, and he is healed and possessed by the dragon that is Satan and declares himself to be God, he is the eighth king that comes out of the seventh kingdom. That he will rule with 10 kings during the tribulation. 3 will fall. Some think it's an assassination attempt, like an assassination attempt made on Hitler numerous times, but failed. They will fail, but out of this conglomerate of nations, these 10 rulers, 3 have fallen, this 8th ruler, this 8th kingdom will come out, and he will not be a man of peace. He will be the dragon. And he will force all men to take a mark in their right hand or their forehead and demand that they worship him. The beast that was, verse 11, is not, is himself also the 8th, and is of the 7, and is going to perdition. Otherwise, his destruction has already been determined. In fact, he, that is the Antichrist, along with his buddy, the false prophet, are the first guest of eternal hell. How would you like that? Satan deceives you, and you end up going to hell before he does. That's a lose-lose situation. I remember right after 9/11, a political cartoon, I forget what newspaper it was in, and it actually showed the devil with his pitchfork, and in the pitchfork was one of the terrorists that crashed a plane into the Twin Towers. And it simply said, gotcha. Otherwise, I deceived you. You thought you were going to heaven with 70 virgins, but I gotcha. And that's what's going to happen here. Gotcha. Except it's going to be no joke. It's going to be no joke whatsoever. Gotcha. He's doomed. He's damned. He's gone. He'll be condemned to the everlasting lake of fire. The 10 horns, which you saw, verse 12, are the 10 kings who have received no kingdom as yet. So this kingdom is not here yet. It may be in the making. It might be in the workings. But until the church is removed, the Antichrist cannot rise to power. And until the Antichrist rises to power, there are no 10 kings. But they receive authority for 1 hour as kings with the beast. They are of one mind, and they will give their power and authority to the beast. And here's what they'll do. They'll be making plans from the beginning, even though they're deceiving the whole world and promising peace. The plans are in motion to do what? Verse 14, to make war with the Lamb. They are already scheming and plotting and planning to come to Armageddon to defeat the Lamb of God. But what they don't realize is they're plotting their own destruction. They're conceiving their own death. Because ultimately, God is sovereign, God is all-powerful, and God is all-knowing, and he will put a hook in their jaw and bring them down to their own destruction. They will make war with the Lamb. So on one side, you have this great red dragon and this beast with 7 heads and 10 horns with names of blasphemy. This harlot, seductively dressed, and they will be on one side of the battlefield, and on the other side is this little lamb. Bah. Bah. And the enemy will think, we got him. We messed up at the conception. We couldn't stumble him in the wilderness at the temptation. Somehow, he rose from the dead. But now we got him. Well, let's read. The Lord, these will make war with the Lamb. And the Lamb will overcome them. Boom. That's it. There's no fight. There's no sweat. There's just bloodshed. And it all comes from the Lamb of God. He is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And here's the beauty. And the Lamb will overcome them. Why? For he is a Lord of Lords and the King of Kings. And here, I like this part. And those who are with him. Yeah, that's us. called, chosen, and faithful. Called by God, chosen by God, and made faithful unto God. Paul said this to Timothy. He says, God who has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose. Otherwise, Paul doesn't understand why God chose us. Only God knows why he chose us. But according to his own purpose and grace, which was given to us in Christ Jesus before time began. He told the Ephesians in chapter 1, just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. You may not know why God chose you. You may not understand why God called you. But let's celebrate that he has chosen us and he has called us and he has set us apart and he has called us his own. And he will make sure that we remain faithful unto him. Then he said to me, the waters which you saw where the harlot sits are the peoples, multitudes, nations, and tongues. So the beast will be there. The serpent will be there. The multitudes will be there in the valley of Armageddon. The Lord will be there, the Lamb of God, along with the army of heaven, which is the church. And the 10 horns, which you saw, verse 16, on the beast, these will hate the harlot, make her desolate and naked, eat her flesh, and burn her with fire. Thus the useful idiot's done away with. For God has put it into their hearts to fulfill his purpose. I love that about the Lord. Man thinks they can pull one over God. You know what God says about that? Read Psalm 2 sometime. Me and my Holy One scoff at you. We deride you. In fact, God says, you better make peace with my son. Kiss his ring. Bow to him, or I'll do away with you. Because I have promised my son the nations as his inheritance. And he will rule and reign with an iron scepter. Isn't that beautiful? For God has put in their hearts to fulfill his purpose, to be one mind, to give their kingdom to the beast, until the words of God are fulfilled. Everything the beast does, everything the harlot does, everything Satan does, is all in accordance with God's perfect will. And the woman who you saw is the great city which reigns over the kings of the earth. That is the demise and the destruction of the apostate church. What does that mean for us today? I cannot answer this question, but you can honestly. Do you belong to the true church or the professing church? The true church is destined for heaven. The professing church is destined for hell. The true church will go in the rapture. The professing church will be left here for 7 years of God's wrath. The true church has been purified of her sins. The professing church is still steeped in her sins. The true church is being protected by God. The professing church is out from under the protection of God. What is the difference between the true church and the professing church? John tells us best. He says, those who believe that Jesus Christ is of God or is God, that man, that woman belongs to him. Jesus said to his father in John 17, chapter 3, he says, this is eternal life, that man may know you. And the way man knows you is by knowing me. Do you know Jesus Christ? If you know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, then you know God. And if you know God, that means that you have eternal life. You belong to the true church. If you are not a follower of Jesus Christ, you've never surrendered Jesus Christ, you're still steeped in your sins, you belong to religion, but not to the Lord. Let's pray. Father, we come to you right now, and Lord, you ask that question of us. And for some, Lord, it's very important because we don't know what the next day holds or even the rest of this day. You could come at any moment like a thief in the night. We who belong to you, we are looking for you. Our eyes are fixed upon you, and we're ready for that day to come. But those who do not know you will come like a thief, and Lord, they will not only be left behind, but if they continue on in their sins, they will be eternally separated from you. So, Lord, for any man, any woman today will simply confess themselves as a sinner, repent of their sins. That means to turn from you, from sin, and turn to you, asking you to forgive them and to come and live inside of them, creating in them a new nature, a nature that follows you. Are you here today and you've never given your life to Christ? You can. It's just simply that. Telling the Lord, you know you are a sinner. You repent of that. You believe that He is the Son of God and God Himself, and that He died for your sins. And you invite Him to come into your heart. He will clean you up. He will empower you. And He will break the curse of sin and the penalty of sin from off of your life. And you become a follower of Him. And He'll spend the rest of the days you have here on earth conforming you into His image. After we finish praying here, we're going to close with a song. If that's you, and you've heard this, and you've already prayed that in your heart, I invite you to come forward after we're done with this song. And our prayer partners will pray that prayer with you, agree in prayer with you, and welcome you into the family of God. Lord, we thank You for this day. And Lord, help us who are the true church to live worthy of the calling we have received and to be a bright, shining light to those who are still in darkness. That, Lord, You would help us by Your Spirit to not compromise our testimony, not to cause men to profane You or blaspheme You by the way we are living, but we would be a shining example of the power of God into salvation. What happens when one man or one woman surrenders their life fully to You? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand. God bless you guys.